Give me a second. I'm eating. I'll get back to you guys in a couple of seconds. Okay. What's up, guys? This is Dan Keys, and today I'm going to be continuing building my tech for my VTubing application. I got some ideas as I was about to start the stream, so I kind of want to write those ideas down. I also decided to start in just chatting because I usually end up talking for, you know, how many hours, 20, 30 minutes before I actually get into doing some stuff. Okay, so DVT app ideas. Okay, now. Actually, give me a second. Okay, so, I've been working on networking stuff, right? I've been working on networking stuff in both C# and Python. And I've been trying to learn how to do socket programming on both of them. Because like once I get an idea of the workflow, I can easily communicate between any Python script and any C# program that includes Unity. So I also need to. So in one of the previous streams, I had finally figured out Python socket programming. In today's stream, I want to practice more C# socket programming, but this time I want to do the socket programming using tasks instead of just... Oh, shit. Hold on. Okay. Sometimes I have to just bend my keyboard a little bit to get some of the keys working. I think this keyboard is like... It's been on its way out for the past couple of months. Anyways, so yeah, I wanna do it using tasks instead of, so basically using task-based asynchronous programming instead of event-based asynchronous programming. So yeah, I already know how to do socket programming just like in general. Using the blocking methods, but the idea is to not use blocking methods because, well, blocking methods block your main thread, and with a standalone C# application that might not necessarily even with a standalone C# application it can have negative effects, But when you're talking about something a little more sophisticated, like a Unity application, it blocks the entire application. So if you're running it in the Unity editor, for example, it's going to block the main thread, it's going to block the UI, it's going to block everything, and your editor is going to freeze until that operation completes. And if the operation is left hanging, you're just going to have to crash the program. So, yeah. I'm planning to add networking. So, hold on. Let me see if you guys can see my mouse cursor. I think you should be able to. Let me just see if... Okay, yeah, there's the mouse cursor. So, if you look over here, this is my VTubing avatar. It's very bare bones. It's very basic. I wanted to set up something basic so that I would have something up and running and be able to create the program around it. I can work more on the avatar later on, but for now I need to figure out the basic foundation for the app itself. So one of the ideas that I've had is I'm planning on sending input messages into this app through the network. So there's going to be a remote control app which is going to be running on another system. But just for the sake of emergencies, or in case there's any like technical issues or anything, I want to also add the option to provide input, to send input locally, so like with the keyboard and mouse. But mainly I'm planning on using networked input. It's going to be sending JSON messages, and those JSON messages will be parsed on the other end, which is on this system. And depending on what the input message is, it'll act accordingly. So I need to create the input system so it reads these messages and triggers inputs accordingly. I need to figure out a design for how I want to go about doing this. So like, okay, let's have this like on paper, right? We have the input system. The input system I'm not sure how to do like a diagram here. Okay. I could open up MS Paint. But no, I'm gonna need to bring up a second window capture, and then that's gonna be messy. Let's just do it here. So actually, you know what? This just gave me an idea. I could create a marker system. That's actually a good idea. Holy shit, wait. Marker system. Maybe I should call it something else. Pen system? Yeah, okay. Let's just call it pen system. System that allows drawing on screen. Implementation wise, this is most likely just gonna be... Actually, I have to see how I wanna go about doing this. Because like one method that I could use that might be... I don't know how performance friendly it's gonna be. But like I can use decals I can use decals. So something similar to how like blood splatter effect works. It just creates the, it just splatters the texture on top of whatever is there. I'm gonna have to see how to go about doing that, because so the idea is I have this, like this is my entire screen. Even like where this where the avatar is doesn't really matter, because what I'm gonna be doing is I'm gonna create a quad in front of the camera, and I'm gonna be drawing on that. Actually, I wonder if I should sort it so it's rendered behind the avatar. I could change the sorting order. I should be able to change the sorting order. So the idea is that I'm gonna have a quad rendered in like in front of the camera, and then just based on just with my mouse, so I can like do something like this. Like I can left click and then draw. This will be. I think this will be more. I think I'll be using it quite a bit, especially since I do like, you know, I tend to do like a lot of trying to explain things and trying to visualize whatever I'm trying to explain. I think it'll be helpful. I'm probably not gonna, you know, accomplish a whole lot, because I'm drawing with the mouse. Something I want to look into is trying to do the drawing using my hand. Well, using my hand as a mouse cursor. I'll have to see how to go about doing that. I mean, I have one idea that I could use. That is, and that's probably gonna be another system running on the app. But yeah, what I could do is I could capture OpenCV data and using a webcam. I could capture hand tracking data using either OpenCV or MediaPipe. MediaPipe would probably do a much better job in terms of like what kind of data it can capture. I think like in the back end it does use OpenCV, but there's like a lot more sophistication there. There's a lot more than just using OpenCV when you're using MediaPipe. So I'm going to use MediaPipe and capture hand tracking data. And I had this idea before as well. I wanted to capture hand tracking data and try to control on-screen UI elements using that. That would have been a fun project. I could still do that. But then I kind of changed from that to, like, in terms of, like, instead of having UI that I could control on screen, that I could, you know, click, interact with on screen. Instead of having that, I could just set up an LLM on another system and I could give it commands, like vocal commands that, hey, do this, do that, do this, do that. And then it'll send in the, you know, the appropriate input. I'll have to find a lightweight model that I can tune specifically for this purpose. It has to be like super lightweight, because I don't actually need something that's that heavy. You know what, maybe I don't need, so I need something that can synthesize my vocals into, no, I probably shouldn't go into the NLP part of it, the natural language processing part of it. Because like, then I'm going to spend time learning how natural language processing works, and I'll try to go deep into the math of it and try to create a model from scratch and all that shit. I don't want to waste time doing that. At some point, if I need to, I'm fine with doing it for the sake of learning. But if I get distracted with it and just, you know, try building it from scratch, I'm going to lose another 2 weeks with just being distracted in this thing. So I don't want to do that. Instead I could use an LLM, and I could initially I could give it commands. Actually, I'll have to look into a customizable. Would I need an LLM necessarily for this purpose? or would just any simpler language model suffice? Because the idea with this language model would be, I would give it vocal commands, and it would take my vocal input and produce. So the input would be my audio, which is, you know, vocal commands. The output would be JSON messages, or the output would be input messages for my application. I think that would be fun to code in Python. Yeah, dude. I think that would be fun to code in Python. The thing is, my mic is attached to this streaming system. So I'm gonna have to run the audio capture here, because it has to be like a constant stream running. In terms of audio, I'm gonna have to see how to go about it, because I haven't streamed audio, or at least programmatically, I haven't sent it over the network. So I have to see first what's a good way to do that. And then I'm gonna have to set up a script that captures the audio on this system, a Python script that captures the audio on this system and then sends it over to another system where all of the processing will take place with the LLM. I don't want to run the LLM on this system because it's gonna really bog down the streaming system. So I'm gonna run it on another system, which is perfectly fine because I have two old systems that, while they are not nearly as powerful as this current system that I'm running, which, I mean, this current system is not that powerful either, but like the other two systems are quite a bit older than this one. So they're limited in what they can handle, but they can still handle quite a bit. So what I'm gonna do is this is why it was a good idea for me to start in just chatting, because like I've just been coming up with ideas. Oh, you know what? Let's write down the idea. External app sending messages over the network. Okay. Two ways to go about this. So the first way will be a remote control app. App with our Unity app with UI. User interacts with UI and app sends input messages out accordingly. DVT app receives these input messages and processes them. Okay, great. Next possibility is what should I call this? Because the other one I'm calling a remote control app. What should I call this one? Something that says that it's a it's a vocal system rather than, you know, having to click on stuff. Actually, while I'm at it, I might as well add the third one as well. So let's say a couple ways to go about this. this would be fun to program on stream because I can then capture. All of these are possible. This first one is definitely possible. This is like the simplest one to do, and I'm probably going to set it up. The other two, they're going to be learning. I mean, even this one is going to be like a learning experience. Pretty much anything that I work on, it's a learning experience for me. So me saying that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Okay, so what should I name this? Voice input app. No. Voice control app. Actually, you know what? I'll restart the other two projects. I'll rename the other project, not the other two, the other one project that I have so far for the remote control app. I'll rename that to man, shit, naming things is so hard. Even naming variables, I kind of get stuck with naming. I get stuck with naming variables more often than I get stuck with actually coding any kind of logic. Okay, what should we call this? Dude, being in just chatting was definitely a good idea. At this point, like, even if I end up talking for like an hour or even 2 hours, I just spend doing this. I don't really have a problem with that. Okay. So it has to be remote, right? Remote. Okay, so we have remote control app. I don't want to call it remote voice app. Okay, let's say remote UI control app. And then this one would be a remote voice control app. And then the other one will be remote. What's a good way to describe on-screen capture? Remote hand tracking control app. That is a mouthful. Though, I mean, it describes it accurately, right? Remote hand tracking control app. So the voice control app. I should probably also mention here. What am I doing? Yeah, I should probably also mention here Python. This is going to be Unity, C Sharp. And then this is also going to be Python. Okay. So, okay. So the idea is, Python script on streaming machine captures audio and sends it to, actually, I should probably also mention here, runs on remote system. Runs on remote system. There you go. Unity app with UI. User interacts with UI. Okay. Python script. Actually, I don't need to call it streaming machine. On local machine, captures audio and sends it to Python script on remote machine. Which in this case, the second Python script would be the remote app. Okay, you know what? I can probably abbreviate all of these. Okay. This would be RVCA. This would be RHTCA. Yeah. Okay. Give me a second. Okay. So there's a couple of different ways that I could go about doing this, right? I should probably also mention what my train of thought was. I need to find a way to make all three of these methods work. So if I know that I'm going to be having these three systems, maybe I should also mention in the input message. So I should probably create a protocol. Actually, yeah. I probably need to create my own messaging protocol. Let's call this DVT MP. DVT messaging protocol. That makes it sound a lot more complicated than it is. It's basically a protocol. It's think of it as a standard that I'm gonna create for what the message is supposed to look like. Because we have three different, just as an example, we have three different remote control apps here, right? And we also have the main VTubing app. So we have four different apps that are going to be communicating with each other. Three of the apps, which are the remote control apps, they're definitely going to be communicating with, they're not going to communicate with each other at all, for that matter. They're all going to be communicating with the main VTubing app, but they all are sending different types of data, right? So in order to parse that data, I could set up like three separate protocols so I can parse the data accordingly, or I could set up one protocol, and in that all the three apps, all the three other remote apps will create their messages using that protocol. And then once it's received on the streaming app, I can parse it accordingly. So I forgot what JSON syntax is supposed to look like, so let's do it in like this way. Let's say root. Under root we have what should we call this? App type, remote app type. No, remote app. This is most probably going to be actually, I could just send an enumerator I could just send a number, is what I mean, instead of a string. That could work out. Because that way I won't be comparing strings, I'll be comparing numbers instead. Yeah, I think we can do that. Remote app. Below is the description of the protocol mentioning all the fields. And what they do. No, all the fields, types of fields, and their descriptions. Okay. So we have remote app, which would be an int, because it's just going to be an enum. So this is gonna describe what type of input we are getting. I'm gonna need to I just got a little loss in my thoughts about I'm trying to imagine the design that I'm gonna follow. Okay, there's an ad playing, so I'm gonna stay quiet for 30 seconds while the ad finishes. Okay, welcome back. So, I'm trying to think about how this is going to be parsed on the other end, on this end. I could make it so there's the input system, and the input system has sub-input systems, if that makes sense. I could make it so the input system is a base class, and then I could create three sub input systems that inherit from the base class. So any functionality that's common to all three of them, it'll be in the base class. Maybe I could also create an interface to make sure that every class has every subsystem has specific methods that are needed. Yeah, I could do that. I'm gonna have to sit down and think about. See, this is where I get stuck, because I'll think of the design. I haven't implemented it yet, but I'm thinking of it. It's all on paper. And I haven't implemented it yet, and then I'll just keep on getting. You know what? Okay, I'm just getting lost in design thoughts. So let's just carry on with this. Okay, so remote app type. This is going to be an int. I need to be able to describe this. So I'm going to describe it in very broken JSON. So in the root, so this is going to be the message within this entire block. This is going to be our message. Right, it's going to be JSON. It's going to contain remote app type. It's going to contain obviously we need the message body itself, but what other information do we need? because like I don't want to have to change the protocol design after it's been implemented. Okay, we have message body. What's a message body gonna be? I feel like I need to make it a little more sophisticated even in the message body. Because like the message body could just be a blob, right? But like, how's the user gonna know what exactly they're supposed to? Okay, let's first describe what these systems are gonna send out. In the case of the remote UI control app, what's it gonna send? It's, yeah, I'm not sure what's it gonna send. It could send events that need to fire. It could send well, I know what events it's supposed to send. Data to send. Give me a sec. Okay, so data to send. Actually, you know what? I need to get up and do my, you know, hourly physical activity. So I'm gonna switch to the BRB screen for like 5 minutes. You guys enjoy the music in the meantime, and I will be right back.
All right.
So, we are back. Oh. So, back to brainstorming. Is the music still going? I actually have my earphones off. Oh, by the way, I'm playing the Birthday Massacre's music. Shout out to the Birthday Massacre. Go check them out on YouTube. They make amazing music. They also have a Patreon if you want to support them. Okay, so what kind of... So let's say the remote UI control app gets an event, or let's say a button is pressed in this app, and it has to send the data over to the main VTubing app. What is that message supposed to look like? Because I feel like that should be another class, shouldn't it? Like, it would be... So, fortunately, the remote UI control app is also going to be a Unity app, so it's also going to be done in C#. So, the exact same class that I'm creating to create the JSON message that's going to go out, I can use that exact same class in the main VTubing app as well. Okay. All right, so yeah, how? Oh, okay. The data to send could be event type, which could be an int, and then event body, which will contain whatever the value is. Or, I mean, it doesn't even have to be event, it could just be event name and event value. Should I call that event value? Event name and event body. Event body could be... I don't want to create another class for that. So instead, should I create another class? I think, because like, what exactly is that going to contain? It's going to contain whatever value, right? So if a button has been pressed, it'll send, you know, on click true. Or button clicked true. If a slider value has been changed, then the slider value is what's going to be sent. The slider value is always a number, usually a number. So I could send it as a float. That's fine. If it's a checkbox, it would be a boolean. Now, I guess that would depend on the type. Should I also check the type? Maybe I should check the type. But no, then like, how am I going to send in, let's say I want to send in a vector. Well, okay, I could send in a vector 3 or a vector 4. That's not a problem. No, you know what? It would be simpler for me to encode it to an array of bytes, or convert it to an array of bytes. Yeah. Okay. So let's name this event value. And above that, we can have event value type. Event value type can also be an int. So I can like specify it as an enum, for example. And then event value is going to be a byte array. So, yeah, okay, that should be the entire image, right? That should be the entire message, right? And what are we sending here? In the message protocol, we have the body. The message body is going to contain, oh, okay. So we're going to call this message body. Okay. I can add comments here. Name of the event. Should be an enum. Okay, next we have type of event value. Should be enum. Event value, type of value contained in event value. Byte array containing byte array containing containing event value. Yeah, cool. Type is determined by event value type. Okay, so the way that we can go about this is, this is going to be the message body. So if the remote app type is a remote UI control app, then it will automatically look for this type of message body. Okay, cool. Now, how do I want to go about doing this? I actually, to be honest, I don't even know what the hand tracking app is going to be sending, because I haven't like tested any of it out yet. However, the remote voice control app, it could, if you think about it, it could probably send, it could probably send the exact same message body, right? Because in one scenario, The message body is formed based on which UI element is clicked or which UI element is interacted with. But in the second scenario, the message body is formed based on which UI element I'm telling the LLM to interact with. So like the LLM is then going to form the input message accordingly. Okay. Sorry about that. I'm just watching something. Okay. Oh, okay, it's getting kind of hot, so let me turn on my AC. Give me a few seconds. I'll just turn on the AC and come back. Okay. Man, I thought I was going to be doing some coding today, but apparently not. Which is perfectly fine by me. I'm creating the design, which it's kind of cool that I'm creating it on stream. Like, I'm happy about that. Just coming up with ideas and noting it down. Hopefully at some point I'll be implementing this. Now, okay. We've established that the message body for both remote voice control and remote UI control are going to be the same. I have to think about what type of message I'm trying to send. Excuse me, I'm just eating. I'm eating and also thinking about stuff. I'll let you know what I'm thinking about in a couple of seconds. Just BRB. Okay. So I'm trying to oh, I was a bit far away from the mic. Also give me a second. I just need to make sure that the music is still going. No, it has stopped. The album is over. I'm gonna switch to another album. Once again, shout out to the Birthday Massacre. Go check them out. Actually, you know what? The Birthday Massacre have put their songs into okay. So we were just listening to Walking with Strangers. Next, I'm saying we will listen to it as if I'm actually listening. You know, or why am I not listening to it? Let me put on the earphones. Okay. So, just a second. Let me make sure we're good on audio. Yes, we are. Great. So, forget about the technical side of it. Python script, oh, actually, yeah. Holy shit. I didn't think about that. There's going to be another element to this. It's not just the LLM. There's also going to be a In fact, the speech to text system, I don't think it uses the same kind of NLP. So like what I was just typing doesn't even make sense. Okay, Python script. Captures audio and does. Now, see, okay, this is gonna be a problem. Okay, because I don't want to do any processing on this streaming system. The system already has enough of a load. I don't want to add a bigger load onto it by doing any kind of extra processing. And speech to text processing or running an LLM or any other kind of ML stuff, it's gonna put a load on the system, which sucks because if I was running it here, I could use the CUDA capability of this system, because this system, fortunately, it has an NVIDIA GPU. It's not really a high-end card. The system itself is pretty old. So it's not necessarily a high-end card anymore, but it still has CUDA capabilities. So it's going to be able to perform a lot better than running inference on the CPU. So it sucks that I cannot do it on this system, because the other two systems that I'm running it on, neither of them have NVIDIA GPUs. So I have to rely on the CPU to do the work. Okay, anyways. Python script captures audio and sends it. Python script on local machine captures audio and sends it to Python script on remote machine. Using speech to text, using a speech to text model, the audio is converted to text. That text is input into an LLM. Or into a LLM, which then outputs the message body. Right, so I'm gonna have to find a way to set up a system Yeah, okay, so that's gonna be an interesting. That's gonna be kind of interesting. I'm gonna have to set up a language model to interpret text, like me saying, I don't know, change scene, or me saying, enable debug mode. I'm gonna have to find a way to convert that into the appropriate event, the appropriate message body. Now, I could try to make my own language model specifically for this purpose, or I could try to run and dude, I cannot run an LLM. It's gonna be very resource intensive. Even the lightest LLMs, they require like if you look at something as light as Llama, it requires a minimum of like 6 GB to even run. Which I have that, but like the processing power, dude, it needs. I feel like it would also be kind of overkill because I'm not having regular conversations with the thing. If I was having regular conversations, that would be fun. But in this specific scenario, I'm not trying to make like a regular a general purpose conversational LLM. I'm trying to make something that has like a very specific purpose. You know what? This could be an interesting. I could look for models on Hugging Face that allow you to customize them by tuning them in some way. I'm gonna have to learn all about like tuning these models. I don't even know how to like make the models in the first place, so I need to learn all of that. It should be fun. It should be fun. I'll start building it on this system, so you guys will get to see. Okay, but anyways, yeah. The text is input into a language model, not necessarily a large language model, so I'm not going to say LLM, which then outputs the message body. Okay, so let's just say LM. LM might need to be custom built since LLMs, since major LLMs are probably resource intensive. By the way, earlier I was saying that, even Llama, it requires like 6 GB or something. There was another one. I can't remember the name right now, but there was another one that it was. Shit, I can't remember the name. But they had managed to run it on like lower end devices. Actually, for that matter, even Llama, they managed to run it on, I think, a Raspberry Pi or some other system on a chip device. And it ran slow, but it ran. Like that was the whole point. It ran. It was able to process a certain number of tokens, obviously a smaller number of tokens. So I could try and build my own model that's going to process the tokens in a specific way. Because okay, so we've got speech to text that converts the audio into text form. This text then has to be fed into a language model where it's going to be broken down into tokens and then processed accordingly. So I'm going to need to find a way. Actually, once I get into like building these models, I'm sure I'll figure out a way. Right now, it's because I haven't dealt with like building models a whole lot myself. So I'm still not sure how to approach it, but it should be a good introduction to building ML stuff. So far I've mainly only been doing research, learning all the theory stuff. So this should be fun to get into. I'm guessing to a certain extent I'm going to have to involve a neural network of some sort, which fortunately PyTorch does give you the option to build, I think, a couple of different types of neural networks. I haven't looked too deep into it, but I know that PyTorch does give you the option, so that's good. All right, so we've created the design. Okay. Okay, so then message body. Is it the message body or the entire... Oh, yeah, okay. Script then forms a DVTMP. Is that what it was called? DVTMP? Yeah. A DVTMP message and sends it back to local machine where the message is captured by DVT app and processed. Great, okay. Oh, what is going on? Okay, and processed. Who knows? Maybe I don't even need to create a. Maybe I don't even need to create a separate language model. Which, I mean, conceptually it would then be called a language model, but like the inner workings may not need to be as complex and as sophisticated as the bigger language models, because the bigger language models need to have conversations. They need to do a lot of stuff, not just process a specific command and spit out a specific type of message. So like, since I have like a specific set of, you know, rules, I could train the model according to that. Though one downside of this would be, in terms of scalability, if I need to add a new command, I might need to retrain the language model. Which I guess it shouldn't be that much of a headache. At least I'll have like the initial setup going. Man, I'm loving just brainstorming this shit, dude. Yeah, man, this is gonna be fun. I added C sharp and Python tags to the stream tags, because I was planning on doing Python on another system, which is where I was gonna set up the socket client, and I was planning on doing C sharp on this system where I was going to set up the socket server, and also, you know, vice versa in terms of server and client. But then I just got sidetracked and I started doing this, which, to be fair, I'm still working on like the VTubing app, right? So like it technically it's still connected. It's just I'm not necessarily doing this, I'm mainly doing this. Okay. So this would be exciting. Because there are speech-to-text models available out there. Some very good ones, actually. And I won't even need to train those. Like, I just have to use them. I can load it up from Hugging Face, maybe. Hugging Face has a library called Transformers that you can use to load and run various ML models. So in Hugging Face, they, or at least in Transformers, I mean, they have the concept of like tasks. So you specify what type of task it is. So let's say sentiment analysis. You specify that you want to perform sentiment analysis. And then I could be like missing some details. So like don't take it as like exact one-to-one info, but it's something along these lines. You specify the type of task that you want. This is all through Python code. You specify the type of task that you want. And then you give it the data that you want to, let's say you want to do classification, sentiment analysis, right? It's gonna download, if you don't specify a model, it's gonna download one of the default models for you. And then you feed the data into it. So it's gonna then, in your next like two or three lines of code, you feed it the data that you're trying to classify, and then the model is gonna process this data and give you the output. So like, because of Hugging Face Transformers, you're able to do a lot of this complex stuff in just a few lines of code, because it creates an abstraction layer for you, although it may not necessarily be the best for, you know, production environment stuff. Because it does this added abstraction layer, it does come with like a performance cost. It would be a lot. You could probably get better performance if you were implementing the model yourself. Because like with a lot of these ML models these days, it's not just like one component. The model consists of multiple components that are working together. So if you actually want to run the model, you either have to have a pre-made script that the devs, the model creators have created for you, which does the work for you, or you have to write the code yourself. You don't have to create the model yourself. You have to write the code that's going to make these components work together. You're going to have to write the code that brings these components together to form the model. You don't have to like create the entire model from scratch. But fortunately, with many of the open source models, the creators do create scripts that are sort of just ready to use. So you just have to give it the input data, and it's going to give you the output data. I forgot why I went on that tangent, but yeah, I could either use Hugging Face Transformers to do the speech-to-text thing, or I think PyTorch has something for speech-to-text. I'm gonna have to see. Because like, I also need to find a way to actually like get the audio data and process it. I've never actually done that. Like, the most that I know in terms of getting audio is like, okay, you get spectrum data. That's the most that I've done. You get spectrum data, you get samples, stuff like that. So I'm gonna have to see, because like, if you're capturing video, for example, you are capturing frames. If you're capturing an image, it's just one image. But like, if you're capturing video, you're capturing frames. So then you stream those frames over the network, right? If fortunately you are able to make use of compression in whatever way, because like, compression with offline video is going to be different from compression with online video. It's not necessarily going to be the same thing. So if you're able to use compression, maybe you're able to like combine multiple frames together, the compression algorithm is going to handle all of that for you. If I'm able to find something like that, which I'm sure there should be something for that, like video streaming is a thing, right? Actually, no. Why am I talking about video streaming? I should be focusing on audio streaming. Because like in this case, I need to capture the audio from the local system and then send it over to the remote system. And then process it there and then send it back to the local system. Anyways, okay. Let's get back to this. So the LLM is supposed, or well, the language model is supposed to, it's supposed to interpret the text and basically spit out a message body. Or it can spit out like different, you know, parts, and I can form the message body out of that. So since this is happening in Python, it could spit out a list. The list can contain the event name, which is an integer, the event value type, which is also an integer, and the event value itself, which is a byte array. Yeah, in Python, doing the byte array thing should also be relatively easy. I'm wondering if like parsing that on the other end could cause any kind of issue, possibly. You know what? I'll find out if it could cause. It shouldn't. Like that's the whole idea, right? Like you get down to bytes. It's like the most basic. It's like the most primitive form that you can get down to, unless you want to go down to bits. So like it shouldn't. We shouldn't have any like conversion. Well, okay, so. No, we shouldn't have any conversion issues. Oh, yeah. So if I make sure that I'm using the same encoding on both. Wait, what is it interpreting? It's. Or what is it converting? It should be converting. It should be converting values, not strings. Yeah. Yep. It should be converting values, not strings. So I need to specify the supported types. Actually, why not strings? It should also allow strings. But it should also allow, like, you know. Wait a minute, how do I send a vector 3 or a vector 4? I have to find a way to pack that data into. Oh yeah, okay, I can find a way to pack the data. Yeah, that'll work. Or worst case scenario, if it gets a little too complicated to do, I could just send it as a. No, then how am I gonna parse it back? Yeah, okay. I'll find a way. I can find a way. Okay, I keep getting lost in my own thoughts and suddenly I'm like quiet on stream, but like if you saw me here, you would just see me looking up here and there, because like I'm just lost in my own thoughts. All about this stuff. Oh, another thing I want to do is capture body tracking data and hand tracking data and facial tracking data, all three of them, send them into the main VTubing app, and then use that to form a human or a humanoid using point clouds and using point clouds in VFX graph. Because I don't care about how the VTuber looks. I kind of want to get the setup. Like I want to set the thing up. I can then control like the aesthetics however I want. but I want to get the main setup working. So there's actual, you know, hand movement and head movement and body movement and stuff like that. And I want to see like how well that works out, because like I've tried capturing data using MediaPipe. It's decent. It's fairly decent. If I was running this on, if I was running this on a system that had a better processor, a bit more RAM, and possibly even an NVIDIA GPU, then I would probably get a much better result in terms of like, you know, capturing the data. But I mean, it is what it is. That's the best that I'm able to do. So I'm just gonna stick with that. Now, we have written the details for the other two remote control apps. Finally, the hand tracking control app. I'm wondering if I should make this message body also a standard kind of thing. Because if that's the case, then I can just define the entire thing in the message protocol, right? So let's see. We have event name. Should I change it from calling it event to something else? Like I could just call it name and value, and of course value type. Because like the message doesn't necessarily only have to send events. Actually, that's a good point. You know what? Yeah, let's not do that. So I'm gonna, for now, I'm not gonna delete this, but we are gonna move this over to here. So this is our message body. What just happened? Okay. So this is our message body. I need to save this because I don't want to lose all of this. Give me a second. Just give me a second. Wait, I had a quick to-do list. I had also just a second, guys. What was it? DVT controller app, VTuber app. Did I have one for the temp app? See, I'm wondering now if I should make a temp app notes thing. Oh yeah, I have one. No, that's a project. Is that the project? No, what is... What's the... No, that's the entire folder. Huh. Yeah. Let's just create a new thing here. Just give me a second, guys. I have to do something. So where was it? Stream stuff. VTuber app, temp. Okay. So I'm calling this the temp app, but like it seems like this is gonna be the main app now. Wait, why did I do that? No, don't do that. Let's delete that. And here we can call this DVT temp app notes. And that's going to be a text file. Okay, cool. It's saved. Great. So now we can Okay. We are good now. Also, this thing that you see in the bottom right corner, I kind of want to add this to the main VTubing app. So that way I don't have to set it up on OBS. Cuz like the VTubing app is it's basically an overlay. Okay, yeah, it's overlaid onto the. Sorry, I got kind of distracted with something. Give me a second. You see, during times like these, I feel like if I had like body movement going on, because like you guys would see my body movement. If I had like body capture, you guys would be seeing the VTuber app moving. Right now you're mainly just seeing the shapes moving. Okay. So we can change this. Now, how would I justify having just name? Like what would we be calling this? Just message body name, so it's the name of the message body. That doesn't make sense, because like it makes sense to just call it value, like value 1, value 2. Though, if I change this to event name, if I change this to just name, then it being an integer is not really gonna make a whole lot of sense. I'm wondering if I should call it message type. Give me a second. Oh, I didn't even realize that there was an ad playing. Okay, so how should we structure this? Because it's not all event based, is it? Like, I'm gonna be using this to, well, I mean, this specific, no, yeah, it's not all gonna be event-based. I also wanna be able to use this to send in the body tracking data. That's gonna be a separate Python script that's running, again, on another system, just so I can reduce the load on this system. Oh, sorry about that. I got distracted. Okay. So, what should we call this, dude? Because, like, we are getting the remote. Oh, shit. I'm calling it a remote app type. Should I like further generalize this to just app type? Yeah. Okay, I should probably put this thing into its own category here. So I can add like scratch notes and stuff. Okay, so this is not required. So we can move all of this here. Wait, what just happened there? Yeah, we can move all of this here. Okay. Protocol to use when sending messages between DVT temp app and various other apps. Current possible. Okay. Current possible. Currently, the remote apps and the tracking app will be sending messages to the main app, but in the future, more apps could be added. Oh shit, I just realized that I could probably use LangChain. Yeah, dude, I just realized that I should probably look into using LangChain for this. Because LangChain is very useful for creating systems that you can like chain together, or you're creating systems where you can chain different modules together. So you can create like a modular program. And you can chain multiple different components together to create a more complex system. So I feel like something like, for example, the remote voice control app, I think that could use LangChain. That whole thing could be implemented using LangChain, and then the various components of it would be the speech to text, and then the LLM, and then finally the last component that just it forms the message and sends the message over the network. Oh, in that case, I think one component that would come before speech to text is a component that actually captures the data, that actually that receives the data over the network. So yeah, that's one way that I could use LangChain. Let me just write it down in my list because I have a list here. Inactive Jack Rabbit, hello, welcome to the stream. How's it going? Okay, so I'm here. Let's write LangChain. Great. Okay. Now. You're doing good? That's great. I'm okay. I've just been busy creating. I've been writing documentation for this VTubing app that I'm making. More specifically, the various components that are gonna. Hold on. Is this for work or your free time? Mostly my free time. Yeah. This is my own personal project. Okay, so I'm still trying to figure out if I should call this. Because, okay, you have the message body, right? In the message body. Do I want it to be an enum? Because if we are calling it event, I mean, by that logic, like, okay, if we are capturing tracking data and sending it over, like, would that be considered an event? Because, like, then it doesn't make sense, right? Calling it an event. Event name. But also just calling it message name doesn't make sense. Yeah, that. Let's say I just call it name. The thing is, I need this to be an integer. So it can be compared against an enum on the other side. Because it's going to be a Python script sending the data over, right? Yeah, enum does sound too basic. I'm trying to go for something that describes what's going to be in the message, but also something that fits with both event-based stuff and just data stuff, because I'm as it stands right now, I have four different apps that are going to be using this protocol to send a message, right? Three of those are remote control, what I'm calling remote control apps. So basically, they are going to be sending event-based messages, or rather, they're going to be sending messages of events that are going to be then interpreted by the main VTubing app. Three of those are remote apps, and they're going to be sending event-based messages. But one of them is going to be capturing. It's going to be capturing body tracking data, hand tracking, body tracking, face tracking, all of that stuff, and it's going to be sending that data into the main VTubing app. That's not necessarily event-based. Like that's not an event occurring. It's constantly sending data. Communication name. So here I have to think of, because like, okay, with the remote app, with the three remote apps, I have app type mentioned here. And the app type can be one of the four mentioned types, right? That I described earlier. Three of those are remote apps, and one of those is a tracking app. So based on the app type, I'm gonna interpret or process the message body accordingly. So in each case, the enum of name is going to be described separately. If it's the remote UI control app, the list of enums is going to be separate. If it's the remote voice control app, the list of enums is separate. And if it's the hand tracking app, it's separate, stuff like that. I don't know if communication name necessarily suits that. Would it describe that well? Because initially I was leaning more towards just message name. But like, okay, so if we think about it, the what if I call it message type? I'm just spit. Oh yeah, no, I appreciate the suggestions. I'm taking that into account, and I'm like trying to see how well that would fit. Because like message name, then we have message value type. Okay, let's get rid of these comments for now so it's a little less confusing. Okay, so then we have message value type, and then we have message value itself. Now, message name, I could describe, because message name is also going to be an enum, and in the case of each of these, each of the three remote apps and the one hand tracking body tracking app, in the case of each of these four apps, I'm going to have a separate system handling the type of message. So depending on what type of message we get, this message body is then going to be passed over to the appropriate system that's gonna process the message. So like I'm gonna be able to describe or define different types of behavior for different types of messages. And I can still use the same format, the same sort of structure. That's the word I'm looking for. So message name can be an enum. Message value type can be an enum. And then message value has to be a byte array, so that based on message value type, the message value can be interpreted. That way we can have, let's say int 16, we can have, I still need to figure out a good way to pack four floats together. I could use some kind of like spacing or something like that. And then I could unpack it on the other side. There'll be a solution. So that's not going to be a problem. Vector 4, vector 3. Mostly it's going to be a vector 3 that I'm going to, and that's mainly going to be in the case of tracking data. That's going to be sending like 3D world coordinates. Oh wait, did the music stop? Wait, let me just. You know what? Let's just replay this album. Once again, shout out to the Birthday Massacre. Go check them out on YouTube. They make good music. They also have a Patreon. Okay. So, message name, message value type, message value. Is this gonna be appropriate for? Yeah. Okay. I think that's gonna describe. I think that's gonna be appropriate for like our entire message. So I should call this. Yeah. Now, in the case of the remote hand tracking app, it's a good thing I added remote there, because otherwise it would have gotten confusing compared to like the tracking app itself. Or maybe I could call it a remote hand control app, but like I don't know how well that's going to describe, because like the idea with the remote hand control app is it's gonna, or the remote hand tracking control app, it's a very very wordy name, but like in this case, I don't really care about how long the name is because I'm the only one using the app. And as long as it describes the app pretty well, that should be fine. So how is this gonna work? This is gonna use media pipe. So this is gonna be a Python script. Capture hand tracking and more importantly finger tracking data, because like I need to get the joints of the fingers as well. Actually, is it the joints that it, I don't remember if it captures the joints or like the segments of the finger. So like if you're talking about like your index finger, it would be divided into three segments, but like there's only two joints there, not counting the knuckle. There's only two joints there. I'm gonna have to see. I don't remember. I haven't used MediaPipe in a while, but we will be using MediaPipe as well. That should be a fun stream, doing like body capture and stuff. It captures more than the fingertips. Yeah, it captures from what I remember. Actually, you know what? I can't do it on stream because I don't have the webcam connected to this. But I can run it in a separate project on a separate system that I do have the webcam connected to. I have to remember which one was my MediaPipe project. But yeah, it captures. So they're called landmarks in MediaPipe. They're called landmarks. It captures landmarks for various parts. In the case of, what are you doing with knuckle data? Nothing. I'm not using the knuckle data necessarily. Well, so I'm gonna be capturing hand and finger tracking data. I'm gonna be capturing body tracking data, and facial capture data. All of that is then gonna be translated into the VTuber avatar. So I can like create like a point cloud kind of thing, and then use VFX graph to decide like how that point cloud gets animated, and of course use the body tracking data that I'm sending it. That's one use of it. The second use of I'm mainly only going to be using the finger tracking data, and the position of the fingers. I'm going to be using that for this system here. Actually, no, not just this system here. I'm going to be using it for this remote hand tracking control app. So there's going to be a tracking app separately. Maybe I should call it something different than just tracking app. But yeah, I'm going to capture the tracking data from there, send it. Oh, wait, no, this is going to be capturing. Yeah, okay, so this is going to be capturing just like the other capture app. This is also going to be capturing tracking data, but this is specifically going to capture hand tracking data, which is going to be the fingers and the palms and stuff like that, so that I can then send that data into the main VTubing app. And I can just kind of imagine this. You know, like how on your phone you're able to like touch different things. You don't use a mouse on your phone. You're able to touch things. So what I'm gonna have is it's gonna be UI on the screen, and I'm gonna be able to do sort of a virtual touch because I'm capturing hand tracking data. So I can then move my hand across the screen, and based on where. Like I can then use my fingers to maybe click a button or move a slider or something like that. So that's the idea. In terms of implementation, it might be, you know, a little complex to implement. Hold on, I'm trying to find the MP proj. Was it this one? I think I also need to activate the environment. Hold on. Just give me a second. This one shows the webcam. This one. Nope, it's not this either. We have MediaPipe here. What is this capturing? Okay, what is this capturing? I live in the Middle East. What about you? Your date is off by a day from where I am. You're probably in something close to EST then, I guess. Yeah, that makes sense. So like the day is still not over for you. For me, the next day has already started. Oh, there it is. So this one captures hands. Let me just set this here, and it's 8 p.m. there. It must be early in the morning for you. Yeah, it's 3:30 in the morning for me. So the environment is active, and now I just need to run. Okay, Python 3. MP01 dot py. I'm up late. Yeah, it's pretty late for me. All right. Okay, so you were asking earlier what it's capturing. So it's the landmarks that it's capturing are three points on each finger. So it captures the fingertip and then the two joints there, and then the knuckle is a separate joint that gets captured. And then you have the same thing for like the other three fingers, and you have the same thing for the thumb. And then there is one at like the base of the palm and one in between the thumb joint and the palm base. That doesn't really describe it well, but like, yeah. So I want to send that into the main VTubing app, and I want to do something like, for example, if I pinch. And like if I bring the index finger and the thumb together, that could maybe be considered like, mouse button down or something like that. I can also use the same, once I get this working, if I get this working, I can also probably use this to like draw stuff. That still doesn't make sense to me. If you know where the fingertip is and the knuckle is, then you don't need to know where every other joint in between is. Well, the fingertip, I guess it would depend on like what the application is. Like it is physically dependent on those other two points. Sure, but like in terms of tracking, you would then have to make guesses. And I guess, well, no, you wouldn't have, because like it's like you said, it is physically dependent. And if it is, because like if you're bending the finger in a specific way, are they double jointed? No, I'm not sure what you're talking about. Like is it being considered double jointed by the script? I don't think so. I think the extra two joints that they are calculating, I think they're just calculating it for your convenience, maybe. Or maybe because like when you try to do it for the other fingers all together, maybe it becomes an issue to try and calculate it yourself. Or maybe it's just a convenience thing. I'm not sure. It definitely helps though, not me not having to calculate it myself. I would prefer that they provide this, little extra convenience rather than me having to make guesses. Try to move your pointer finger into the same point, but with your joints. Wait. Try to move your pointer finger into the same point, with your joints. With your joints, between your other finger joints, differently. I don't know why this is, I have no idea why it's bothering you so much. But like in terms of tracking, I'm glad that whatever they've provided, I'm happy with that. I would rather not have to calculate it myself. Because there's a lot of stuff you have to take into account if you're going to be calculating based off of assumptions. Like, I guess my point is you have to move your pointer if your other finger joints are moving. My pointer, so I'm assuming you mean... Wait, do you mean the index finger, or do you mean the pointer that's going to be... like the cursor. So at this point I can close this. Okay. So going back to this, we're gonna capture hand and finger tracking data on a remote system and send that over to DVT temp app on the local machine. Yeah, index finger. You said it keeps track of all three joints along the finger. Yeah, so at this point I've kind of lost track of the conversation. So all I'm gonna say is I'm glad that it captures all of the joints. It's a lot more convenient than it just capturing the tip of the finger and the knuckle of the finger. Because in that case, if I wanted to, for example, apply that tracking data to, let's say, animate a hand, I would then have to make my own assumptions or my own calculations for how the other joints would behave, and well, that won't necessarily always be accurate. Plus, I think there could be other issues as well. I haven't done a whole lot of like capturing tracking data, so like I don't know if there could be any other issues that could pop up there. Anyways, so this will capture hand and finger tracking data on a remote machine and send that over to DVT temp app on the local machine. Wait. As 3D coordinates. That's an important thing. 3D world coordinates. Okay, so then this data can be used to how should I describe what all this can be used for? Oh yeah, so we can say this can be used to create a virtual on-screen pointer, like structure that can be used as a mouse pointer for various purposes. Now, in this case, it's going to be fairly simple. Yeah, okay, so I can get rid of the message body here. Okay. Because, like, everything else should fit right within this same message, within the same message body. You have the message name, the message value type, and the message value itself, which is, it's just going to be a blob. I'm wondering if I should allow something bigger than just that, because like then I could, for example, have something like, I don't know, I could send like bigger messages, like an array of arrays. That would get a little bit complicated than just keeping it simple and sending message by message. Besides, this isn't happening over the internet, it's happening over the network, so I don't think I would have to worry too much about it putting a load on the network, or it being really slow. It's not going to be all that much communication going on. Okay. Is there anything more I need to write about this? So it captures hand and finger tracking data on a remote system and sends that over to the main app on the local machine as 3D world coordinates. This data can be used to create a virtual on-screen pointer-like structure that can be used as a mouse pointer for various purposes. I think that just about describes like what this is going to be used for, because like I don't think there's going to be any other type of processing that I'm going to be doing in this remote app specifically. Like within this remote app, I don't think there's any kind of other processing that I'm going to need to do. Because I'm going to send it over into the Unity app. And then there, I'm going to have to find my own ways to... Actually, hold on. I want to see if there's a way that I can find out if, let's say, two fingertips have touched. Like, if the index finger and the thumb have touched. So then I can, like, consider that a click of some sort. Or I can consider that button down, and then when it's released, it can be considered button up. Okay. Media pipe. Detect pinch. Basically, I need to detect if there's a pinching sort of motion. Simple hand gesture recognition. Okay, so it did mention something about detecting hand gestures. Media pipe, hand gestures. Let's look that up. Media pipe, hand... By the way, I'm doing this on another system, so like it's not going to show up here. Like, if anyone's wondering why it's not showing up on the screen. Hand gesture recognition. Okay, so they have a separate task for that. Okay. Give me a second while I load that up. Gesture recognition task guide. The MediaPipe gesture recognizer task lets you recognize hand gestures in real time. In real time, and provides the recognized hand gesture results along with the landmarks of the detected hand gestures. You can use this task to recognize specific hand gestures from a user and invoke application features that correspond to those gestures. You know what? Okay, at this point, so now I might actually do some extra processing in this tracking app. Because if it can recognize gestures, then why not, you know, take advantage of that. Now I need to see what gestures it can recognize. And I can kind of like work around that. Okay, where is the list of gestures? This is mentioning the landmarks, but like, what about the list of gestures? Okay. The gesture classification bundle, classification model bundle, can recognize these common hand gestures. The first is unrecognized. Then there's close, closed fist, open palm, pointing up, thumbs down, thumbs up, victory, and love. Okay. So I could work around, I could work with these. That would look kind of silly though. Like if I wanted to left click, I'll give it a thumbs up, or I'll point up. Closed fist, open palm, that could work, but like I feel like that would, in some cases, it might accidentally incorrectly recognize gestures, like even when I don't intend on, like trying to use that as a click, it would lead to problems. No, you know what? Okay, I can process it in Unity, in the VTubing app itself, because like I will have the landmark positions, and with the landmark positions, what I can do is I can attach colliders, or I can find other ways. I don't even need the physics system for that. I can just check how close the actually, you know what, should I bother with trying to click? Because I could probably use like a mouse click or something like that. I mean, okay, you know what, I can add that on. That can be added on. That's not an issue. So it's not like I need both of them together. I can add the basic movement, and then later on, if I want to add like click detection or something like that, I can add that feature in. All right, so going back to the pen system, which is what I was initially writing when I suddenly remembered that I had to write all of this extra stuff. Like at this point, I'm probably not even going to be using this local input. I'm mainly going to be using networked input. But I'm still going to add the local input just for the sake of emergency. So I'm going to have to create an input system that has that acts as a abstraction layer. So both the local system and the network systems, they all just, you know, send messages to the input system, and then the input system processes them accordingly. Because like I definitely don't want to use the keyboard and mouse on the local system, because that would mean that I'm not going to be able to use it for other stuff. Like if I have the VTubing app running on my main system here, I'm doing other stuff. Like right now I'm running the VTubing app and I'm also typing stuff here. I'm also moving my mouse, so I'm using it for other stuff. If I make it so the VTubing app accepts keyboard and mouse input, I might accidentally be sending input into it. I could avoid that as well. There are ways to avoid it, but I feel like it would be a lot less messy, a lot less hectic if I just had like a separate, or in this case three separate apps sending input in. The three separate apps are all just convenience. They're different types of input. One of them is it's supposed to be like UI type of input, where I click a button, I click a UI, or I interact with a UI element on an app that's running on another system, and then that sends a message to this computer saying that so-and-so event has occurred, and then this app will act accordingly. Anyways. Okay, so, pen system. System that allows drawing on screen. Implementation-wise, this is most likely just going to be something similar to decals. Place a transparent quad in front of the camera and draw decals on that to represent pen drawing. What else? So it's gonna be a transparent thing. So the app itself is running on a green screen, right? And if I have a transparent quad and I draw the decals on that transparent quad, it's gonna look like it's drawing on the screen. Yeah. Actually, at this point, I kind of want to implement that, like, now. Yo, I'm wondering if I can maybe capture mouse pointer data. I can capture mouse pointer data, so it's not like a maybe there, but like, I'm wondering how well it would work if I captured mouse pointing data, mouse tracking data. In the remote app, and I sent it over to the main app. Yeah, you know, I could do something like that. That would probably make the. Oh wait, no, that's not gonna work well. I just realized like what exactly I'm gonna be using the pen system for, because like if let's say I wanna underline something here, that's not gonna. How am I gonna do that? Well, I mean, I know how I'm gonna do that. It's just how am I gonna send input and have it be. I need to find a way to force it to set the mouse pointer data, set the mouse pointer. Man, okay, yeah, that's gonna be a little complicated because I'm not looking at it at that moment. As in, okay, no, just, I'm not describing this very well. So the problem is, I have the app running. Right, but the app is running in a green screen, the app is running. The app has a green screen. I don't know why I mentioned the green screen. The app is running. It's a separate app, but I have the app minimized, and right now I have VS Code open. So let's say I wanted to like circle a word, or I wanted to underline a word. How would I send the input into that app? Oh, something I could do is, well, then I'm not going to be able to see it. Yeah, that's going to be a problem. I'm not going to be able to see it. Okay, you know what? I'll look into that. I'll look into that because if I don't have the feedback, like if I can't see that I'm the one drawing the thing here, that, or rather, I mean, I know I'm drawing it, but like if I can't see what exactly I'm drawing, then I can't, you know, accurately draw whatever it is. Even if it's something as simple as underlining something or circling something, it's gonna be. Okay. So that's gonna be it for today's stream. I'm gonna stream again tomorrow. Hopefully. I'm going to stream again tomorrow and I'm going to be brainstorming more of this stuff off stream. But guys, thanks a lot for hanging out. Inactive, thanks for hanging out and chatting. Appreciate it. That's going to be it for today. I hope you guys have a nice day, and I will see you all next time. Peace.